Hi everyone, and welcome to our first video exploring exoplanet detection. This is going to be a series of videos covering the different techniques that are central in modern exoplanet discovery work. As explained in the trailer, we're going to start with a short sample series of videos, and if we find support, we'll be able to expand this into a longer series. We're going to start with exoplanet detection because really it's detections that have elevated this field from an ambitious, aspirational idea studied by a handful of astronomers to now a major cornerstone of modern astronomy programs. Whether you're a theorist or an observer, we really have to understand how exoplanet detection works, what it can and cannot measure, and the intrinsic biases affecting those methods before we can interpret the planets that we see. So, where to start? Well, barring rogue worlds, exoplanets orbit stars, and those orbits are central to how we interpret exoplanet data. Understanding the orbit of these exoplanets is a necessary foundation before we can get into the details and intricacies of exoplanet detection. Moreover, an understanding of the orbit is critical to not just detection, but everything from surface habitability to formation modeling. So, pretty much every exoplaneteer will need a mastery of this core skill. With that, let us begin with celestial mechanics, which really just means the movement of heavenly bodies, in our case, planets. We'll be exploring questions like, what is the coordinate system used to model exoplanet orbits? How do planets move around on these orbits? And where do the laws of planetary motion even come from? This first video is going to focus on Kepler's laws. Now, many of you will already be familiar with this and will definitely be light here in terms of technical depth. But let's face it, Kepler's laws are so foundational to this subject that it really makes the perfect starting point. We think of Kepler as being at the beginning of this story, but of course, that isn't really true. The movement of the planets was a subject of study as far back as Babylonian astronomy 3 millennia ago. Now in the modern day, when we hear the word planet, we probably conjure up in our minds images of spherical worlds covered in oceans, mountains, and atmospheres. But planets in antiquity were mysterious objects. They really didn't know what they were, in much the same way how today we really don't know what dark matter is. To them, planets were simply stars that didn't appear in the same position each night. Wandering stars, or in Greek, asteres planetiae. Despite their mystery, they inspired art, religion, and became central to many cultures. Even now, the names of the 7 planets recognized by the Babylonians give us our 7 days of the week. Since antiquity, it was recognized that the motions of these wandering stars was not random. There were certain patterns, rules governing their motion. For example, they always appear along a narrow line of the sky that we now call the ecliptic plane. Understanding these rules was a fascination for many, like trying to learn the mind of God. One such obsessor was Johannes Kepler, a brilliant German astronomer who took on this task in the early 17th century. But of all of the planets, it was Mars that held a special fascination to Kepler. Its motion was perplexing and difficult to explain to good accuracy with any of the models proposed thus far. Not only is Mars a bright and quickly moving planet which facilitates its study, but it often displays retrograde motion, where it appears to temporarily reverse course on the sky. Kepler recognized that Mars was the key to unlocking the secrets of the heavens. By the study of the orbit of Mars, we must either arrive at the secrets of astronomy or forever remain in ignorance of them. A modern-day equivalent of Mars or bust. The Danish astronomer Tycho Brahe hired Kepler as an assistant in 1601 to analyze the planetary motions. Tycho was very influential by this point, having discovered the first nova, which means new star, in 1572, constructed a giant quadrant for measuring stellar positions, and being an astrological advisor to lords and royalty. Tycho recognized that a long-term precise monitoring of the stars and planets was sorely needed due to a lack of agreement between the other astronomers at the time. And it's interesting to note that there are certain parallels there to what we are doing in the modern exoplanet era, where we are now moving into a phase of long-term precise monitoring of the exoplanet population. Tycho resided in a grand observatory called Uraniborg, dubbed the Castle of Heaven. It's interesting to note that the modern cost of this Danish research institute would be about $5 billion, not far off the cost of the James Webb Space Telescope. Tycho was able to catalog the positions of nearly 1,000 stars down to arc-minute precision, some 10 times better than his peers. Although he closely guarded his catalog, he gradually let Kepler access this precise dataset that would really prove crucial to unlocking the secrets of the planets. Kepler, of course, wasn't the first to try and understand planetary motions. A popular model at the time was that the Earth was at the center of the cosmos, a geocentric universe. The famous model of Greek astronomer Ptolemy seemed to do a reasonable job of explaining the planetary motions, and it made sense to many at the time for the Earth to be at the center. After all, we don't feel ourselves moving, and more subtly, when you look up at the stars at night, you don't see any noticeable parallax effect. Of course, it also satisfied the requirement of many religions that the Earth be a special, unique place in the universe. Ptolemy's model didn't quite work for Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn, and so had to be modified to include epicycles. A useful way to think about these epicycles is in terms of Fourier theory. With each addition of an epicycle, we are essentially adding another term to a Fourier series expansion. Now, since any periodic function can be approximated by a Fourier series, then this practice will eventually lead to good fits, but it's also somewhat ad hoc. The alternative was, of course, the heliocentric model championed by Copernicus. The Sun was now placed near the center with the planets orbiting around on perfect circles. It's also interesting to note that Tycho himself proposed a kind of hybrid model that tried to mix the two, with the Earth back at the center. The Copernican model seemed to work quite well too. Advocates argued that the fact that we don't see parallax of the distant stars is simply because the stars are very far away. Galileo's experiments showed that objects continued to move unless acted upon by an external force, thus explaining why, living on a moving Earth, we do not simply find ourselves flying off into space. And even the retrograde motion of Mars could be naturally explained. By plotting the position of Earth and Mars near a conjunction, as shown here, one can see how Mars seems to temporarily reverse course. As a little exercise for you back home, try repeating this diagram on a piece of paper, but with Mars orbiting in the opposite direction to the Earth, and see what you'd get then. Check the description for the answer. So the Copernican model had a lot going for it, but it certainly wasn't perfect. And to see this, let's look at some data. Here is a sequence of position measurements made of Mars, spanning 3 months. Now let's overlay the model predicted by Ptolemy in green, which, as you can see, doesn't quite match the data, but it gets fairly close. Now, let's compare that to the Copernican model in blue. Again, it's okay, but it's not really great at explaining the data. Kepler just wasn't satisfied with the situation, but he felt convinced that the heliocentric model was right. Eventually, Kepler found a better solution, which I'm going to show here with the purple line. As you can see, it's more accurate than either of the previous proposals. So, how did Kepler do it? What I like about this story is that it wasn't easy, and it shows how science really is. Kepler tried approximately 40 different orbital shapes, everything from ovals to spirals, before stumbling across the ellipse as an elegant solution. I mean, think about that. He failed 40 times before he struck upon his success. And let me tell you, Whether you're writing a theory, a big piece of code, or running an astronomical survey, the same thing is likely going to happen to you. You will fail dozens of times. That's part of the process. But through perseverance, success becomes inevitable. This success is what we now know as Kepler's first law, that planets follow elliptical orbits with the sun at one focus. Of course, an ellipse becomes a circle when the two axes are equal, and most of the planets indeed have close to circular orbits. But Mars has a modest eccentricity of 0.0934. That's enough for the ellipse to noticeably outperform the Copernican model. We're now ready to show what became known as Kepler's three laws of planetary motion. But before I show them, I want to highlight that these laws are really just observational statements and empirical deductions. There really wasn't any fundamental understanding as to where they come from and why these laws and not some other laws. That would have to wait until Isaac Newton came along and was motivated to truly understand the origin of these laws. Coming back to Kepler though, his three laws are 1. That planets orbit the sun in an ellipse with the sun at one focus. 2. Planets sweep out equal areas in equal intervals. And 3. The orbital period of a planet squared is proportional to its semi-major axis cubed. Know these laws, love these laws, because these really are foundational in celestial mechanics. The first law is something I think we take for granted for often when we think about planetary orbits these days. And the second law is really just a natural outcome of the deeper understanding that Isaac Newton later presented us with. The third law is kind of interesting though, because yes, it is also a natural outcome of these deeper understanding, but what's different about the third law is that we really do, even now in the modern exoplanet era, use this thing all the time. You will often see Kepler's third law cited and quoted in modern astronomical papers. In fact, we'll come across our first example of this when we discuss the radial velocity method of finding planets. So that concludes this introductory video. We're left with Kepler's laws of planetary motion, stated as almost observational facts, but we don't truly have a deep understanding as to where they come from. So in the next video, we'll address that. We will start with Newton's universal law of gravitation, a single equation, and use it to derive all three of these laws of planetary motion. If you have any questions about this video, then be sure to put them down below in the comments and I'll do my best to answer them. And as always, thank you for watching.